So welcome. My name is Katya, and this is Contractualism and Software Engineering. We're all in this together. So we've all seen this ad, right? Like a million times if you don't have YouTube Premium. We know that it doesn't feel quite right. In this talk, we're going to discuss what about this doesn't feel right and what you as software engineers can do if you are presented with something like this that doesn't feel quite right. So just a couple things about me. I'm Katya. I'm a software engineer at Heroku. I am a second career engineer. My previous and part-time life, I'm a jazz singer. I am an enthusiast of all things chocolate, and I am owned by this cat. Before we begin, we're going to have to zoom way, way out to figure out where morality actually comes from. How do we as human people know what is immoral and what is moral? And we have to really understand this before we can figure out how it applies to us as technologists. So here's one thing that we're not going to use for morality, and that's God. And this is not me making a referendum on religion, but having morality come from God presents us with a paradox. Because if an action is good because God has demanded that we do it, then God can demand us to do all manner of awful things, and we kind of have to do them anyway, even if they don't feel right. On the other side of things, if God demands us to do certain things because they're good, then God doesn't need to have demanded us to do them at all. They would be good regardless. So we're going to leave God out of today's conversation. So why did I choose contractualism, this particular ethical framework? Because there are a lot of really great ethical frameworks that we could go with. So this slide is like a philosophy PhD in three or four words. So we're just going to kind of breeze right by it. So there are three big buckets of ethical theory. So there is agent-centered ethics, which is concerned with the ethical status of an individual. So really, is this person a moral person? Versus, is this action a moral action? And the flaw in agent-centered ethics is that it allows a good person to do bad things. And so, you know, we're going to pause on that one. Next, we have consequentialism, very well named, which really focuses on the consequences or outcomes of particular actions. And again, this allows people to do terrible things if kind of the overall outcome is good, or, you know, if there's a net positive. And this is something the tech industry does all the time. Finally, we have non-consequentialism, really poorly named, but this focuses on the intentions of people who are doing actions. So if your intention is good, then, you know, even if it goes out bad, who cares? You're still, obviously, that's no good. You need the intention, you need the outcome, you need all of the above. And so I like contractualism because it kind of takes all of the best parts of these big buckets of ethical theory and combines it into one ethical system that really just does a lot of things real well. So we're going to watch a quick video from one of my all-time favorite shows, The Good Place, and hopefully it will buffer in time. Come back. Can we read the captions until we fix the volume?
Yes. Yeah.
People
in
the clown,
I'm
gonna lose it.
Thank you.
Psycho, creepo, crazy head, stupid juggling, weirdo, freaky feet, and nightmare George Washington. One of them has to go.
Oh, sexy mailman. Much better.
In 5 minutes, Michael wants my help investigating what's making the neighborhood go nuts, which is obviously me. I mean, I did promise I would help. What do I do here?
Actually, the answer is
right here in this easily understandable comic strip.
Nope, in this book about the theory of contractualism.
What we owe to each other. I saw this movie. Laura Linney cries in a lake house because Jude Law left her for his ex-wife's ghost.
No. Good summary of contractualism. Imagine a group of reasonable people are coming up with the rules for a new society.
Like, if your Uber driver talks to you, the ride should be free?
Sure, but anyone can veto any rule that they think is unfair. So if you said we should be able to break our promises without any repercussions, someone would veto that rule.
Well, my first rule would be that no one can veto my rules.
Well, that's called tyranny, and is generally frowned upon.
So, as Chidi eloquently explains in this clip, highly recommend The Good Place if you are not already watching it. So the book that he brings out in this clip is the seminal book on contractualism, What We Owe to Each Other, by T.M. Scanlon, a philosophy professor from Harvard. And essentially, the way contractualism works is an action is wrong if any principle that permits that action could be reasonably rejected. So obviously, Eleanor's rule in the clip that no one can veto my rules would be reasonably rejected on principle. So the way we decide if something is moral or not is by asking our community. Morality, in this case, makes sense in how people are connecting specifically with one another. So how does this apply to software? So let's talk about a couple of other professions. So we have doctors, we have lawyers, we have architects, and these professions all have a code of ethics that if you violate it, you can lose your job, you can lose your license, you can be essentially kicked out of the field. And the thing that these professions all have in common is that you need to take a licensing exam to join that organization. You basically have a license that you can lose. It can be revoked. And pardon me, tech has a really low barrier to entry. And in my introduction, you know, I'm a jazz singer. I don't know what I'm doing here. But here I am, senior software engineer at Heroku. It's the low barrier to entry in tech has worked really well for me, and I'm not here to badmouth it. But what it does mean is that it's really hard for us as an industry to enforce a code of ethics via license in the way that many other industries that have such a large impact do. Since we can't mandate this code of ethics, I like to think of contractualism as kind of a potential governing umbrella that we can all guidelines that we can all follow as we are technologists in this field. So, how do we actually use contractualism to make better decisions as software engineers? This is the big question. So, I came up with this term, the user stack. Apparently, it's actually a Linux kernel term, but this is not that user stack. So we talk about a tech stack all the time, oh, it's a React front end, Rails back end. So the other side of tech are the users. So we have internal users and external users. Now, usually when we think of a user, we're thinking of the end user, the person who's clicking on the thing. Maybe we think about a customer. Maybe end users and customers are the same. Maybe not. But I'm going to expand our concept of user. And essentially, we can think of each of these user groups as their own mini contractualist communities that we can use contractualism to decide, are we treating these groups of people well? So first we have a company. Does the company treat their employees well? Are the benefits good? Is the salary appropriate? The company is kind of our first bucket of users. I myself am a user. Maybe I'm a user of the product, but I'm also a user of my own code. If I'm looking at my crappy code in 6 months, am I going to run a git blame on it and be like, oh, that was me? Have I documented my own code well enough to be used by either 6 months from now, Katya, or, someone else at my organization? Someone else at my organization, engineers, another type of user here. So, is the code base maintainable? Is it readable? Are our tools up to date? And if new engineers are onboarding, can they onboard smoothly? Is this a good experience for them or not? So we have fellow employees. So this is anyone else at the company. Obviously, this is very engineer-centric, but there are marketers, there are salespeople, there are support folks. So do we provide sufficient tooling for them to be able to do their jobs? Do we provide good products for the sales team to sell? Do people want to buy our stuff or not? We also have customers. Again, customers and end users are sometimes the same, but sometimes they're not. So do customers want to buy our stuff? Are our products appropriate for the budget that we're selling them? And do we provide utility to these people? We also have end users, the most obvious type of user. These are the people actually clicking around, using our stuff. But we really have to think about those people as well. Is our product intuitive to use? Is it accessible to all types of users, or are we thinking of accessibility as last resort when we have time? Okay, that's no good. Also, is it usable only by people who maybe look a lot like our all-white male engineering team? So I couldn't think of a better term for this, end users' users. So this is someone who is affected by a user who's using the product, but has no choice in the matter. So are we treating those people well? You know, these people are not people who've opted in. They have just kind of been forced along this ride with us. So are there resources that we could be providing to them that we're not providing? Is there tooling? Are there tools for our end users to help their own users? And finally, is what we're doing good for the world? Often in tech, it's harder than we would like to make that call if we're doing good or if we're doing bad, honestly. So bringing this back to contractualism, actions are morally right if they are justifiable to each person. So I like to think of contractualism very much as a group activity. You know, moral people are formed and come to know themselves in their interactions with one another. And so we as engineers are doing this as we build products. And as we're building products, we want to think about each user in that user stack and ensure that no group of users is going to disagree with the decisions that we're making on principle. So, yeah, this is hard. This is a lot of stuff. This is a lot of things to think about when you're just being asked by your boss to, like, write this feature or fix this bug. And, you know, one of the reasons I like contractualism so much specifically is because the goal isn't to find a single perfect solution where everyone is like, this is the best ever. I love this all the time. But it's to find a solution where no one could, like, reject what we're doing on principle. It's to find a solution where no one in the group feels like they have been harmed by the work that we're doing. And our morality, you know, we may be engineers, but surprise, we're also human beings. And our morality comes from treating our users with respect. So let's look at a few examples. So we've all seen something like this. There's a comment above a chunk of your code. I don't know what this does. I don't know if this is documented. I don't know if it's tested. I don't even know if it really works. Whatever is in the method is really hard to parse. It's hard to grok. My favorite is when you see like a bunch of dates of like all the times that people have come across this method and had this problem and like no one's had the wherewithal to fix it. So let's look at our user stack and see who this is benefiting and who this is harming. So let's say that I wrote it. Maybe this benefited me because I didn't have a lot of time and like I was having a grand old time just writing crappy code. But I also argue that this harms me because 3 months from now, Katya is probably gonna come across this method and be like, oh no, what was I thinking? You know, you never know your own code better than when you're writing it. And if you leave kind of sloppy methods and sloppy code in there, it's only going to get harder to fix. This obviously is going to harm every other engineer at the company who comes across this very hard to read method. It's also maybe going to harm your fellow employees who now are like selling and supporting products that like have untested code in them. And these sorts of things can really just like cascade. It depends obviously on like how important, how critical this whatever method is, whatever chunk of code it is. But this can really like cascade all the way down. You can end up doing a lot of harm to a lot of people when you have poorly tested code. So let's go back to our initial example, YouTube. I don't pay for YouTube Premium. I'm much too cheap for that. So I see this constantly. They charge $4 a month more if you are signing up on your mobile phone. Now I know this is because like app stores are taking fees. It's not because YouTube like hates us probably. But you know, let's talk about who this sort of thing is helping and harming. The company, YouTube, Google doesn't have to lose any money no matter where you sign up. Obviously. But customers and end users are very harmed here. This is the sort of thing where, like, if you don't know about this discrepancy, you may end up, like, paying, honestly, hundreds of dollars more over the course of your subscription just because you didn't know or you weren't able to sign up on desktop. This is obviously bad for the world. This is a bunch of money that kind of just, like, goes into the ether. Obviously, it's going into the pockets of Apple and Google, and it's kind of weird for like YouTube to be charging this money, like probably on their own app store, but that's neither here nor there. But here's the thing. Americans with lower incomes often don't have desktop computers. 76% of people who make $30,000 a year or less own a smartphone. Only 59% of people in that bracket have a desktop computer. So this is 17% of these people who don't even have the option of getting the more affordable version. So like small things that seem like minor annoyances to someone like me, like actually can have real serious implications to the greater world. Next example we have is from this great book called Weapons of Math Destruction by Kathy O'Neill. It's kind of creepy up here. So, all right. In the United States, if you are a shift-based hourly employee, if you work a certain number of hours, your employer is required to provide benefits to you. If you work fewer than a certain number of hours, they don't have to provide any benefits. So there is shift scheduling software that allows a shift manager, a user, to just like toggle a switch that says, make sure no one gets benefits. Make sure no one works enough hours to receive benefits at this time. So when I heard about this, I was like, okay. So there was a product manager who was like, I have a great idea, guys. We're just going to introduce this toggle, and then our customers are going to be happy. And then there was a software engineer that was like, super duper, I'm in. I'm going to build you this toggle. So let's talk about who's benefiting and who is being harmed here. The company, the employees, the salespeople who are selling the software, they're doing great. This is clearly a feature that like some morally bankrupt human wants. The customer, so let's say this is like a McDonald's or whatever, they're probably saving a bunch of money, like not having to provide benefits to their workers. The end users, so these are the shift managers who are like actually using and setting the shifts here. So maybe they had to do this before the toggle existed, and now they don't have to do it manually anymore. Maybe they're actually like saving a bunch of time because now they have this like toggle of evil right there. But I argue this harms the customers of this software. You know, you don't want a workforce that has no paid time off, that has no health care. This is a bad thing. I should not have to convince, you know, fellow humans that like it's good to deny people like the care and services they need. Same with the shift managers. I don't know if you've ever worked in like a service-based job, but usually the shift manager was a shift worker first. And so they're probably having to like look their friends in the eye and be like, sorry, I had to use the toggle this month, like no health insurance for you. Also, these shift workers, these are the end users' users. These are the people who did not opt into this, and yet they are affected by our decisions. They are clearly, obviously harmed. And then the world, like now we have whole chunks of employees who are specifically being denied benefits. So that means they don't have health care. It means they don't have paid sick time. So maybe they're coming to work sick. Maybe, oh, I don't know, there's a pandemic going on and they have to go to work sick because they don't have time off if they get exposed. And now we go in and now we're exposed. And it's just, these are the sorts of like, seems like a minor technical decision that really is just going to cascade all the way down. So my final example is a facial recognition example. And there are a lot of people, probably many people here, who can talk much more eloquently and more knowledgeably than I can about ethical AI. It's a very well-developed field, but I have to mention this because it's just such a horrifying example. So this is Robert Williams. He was arrested and spent a night in jail because facial recognition software identified him as the perpetrator of a crime. And those charges were ultimately dropped because, like, if you looked at the photo, the security video, and you looked at Robert Williams, it's, like, very obvious they're not the same person. But they were dropped without prejudice, which means that he could actually be retried on these charges if the police officers chose to do so, or the prosecutors. I don't know how law enforcement works. The way this particular facial recognition software is supposed to work is, let's say, God forbid, I'm a police officer, and let's say I'm a police officer, and I have a security video of a crime being committed, and I run it through my facial recognition software, it pops out a name. Now, the way I'm supposed to use this facial recognition software is to use that as a guideline, to be like, this is what the criminal may or may not look like. Or maybe it pops out 10 names, and now I'm supposed to go and do the legwork, investigate those people. Were you in the area? Do you happen to have this flat screen TV that the person in this video stole. But instead, what law enforcement officers are doing is they are just running it through the facial recognition software, they get a name back, they go arrest the guy, their job is done, bada bing, bada boom. Robert Williams has spent a night in jail for no reason. Now, the facial recognition software company that in this particular case says that, yes, this is the way you're supposed to use the software is, again, as a guideline. But we don't actually advise law enforcement agencies that you're supposed to do that. We just sell them the software. So facial recognition laws are popping up all the time. It's banned in San Francisco and Boston. Obviously, Facebook was just in the news for, thank goodness, deleting their facial recognition database. But facial recognition isn't going anywhere. And so how it is used by people really needs to be handled with care. And if you are ever in the position to be working on it, you need to be using that same care as you're building it to ensure that it is like as unlikely as possible that a man like Robert Williams spends any moment at all having anything less than a fabulous time with his life because of your software. So, all right, who is benefiting? I'm relatively biased here. I think no one benefits here, but obviously people are buying the software, so they think they are benefiting from it, these customers. They probably think they're getting a shortcut to solving cases. Probably, like, even if you make an arrest that doesn't, like, pan out, that counts for your numbers or something. Again, I think that arresting the wrong person for something they didn't do should be something that harms you as a police officer. I don't know if that's the case, but certainly if I were a police officer, I would not want that to happen. Obviously, Robert Williams is an end user's user. He had no choice in this matter. He just had an incredibly traumatic experience done with him. And, you know, this is not rare. This is extremely common. There is obviously a very specific racial component because so many dev teams are very, very white. The darker skinned you are, the more likely it is to misidentify you. And so this is something that has very, very serious implications for the wider world. This is a very clear, essentially harm differential that I don't know if anyone here works on facial recognition, but in the tech industry, we essentially can be perpetrating these sorts of things. So what do we do, right? You know, when I was researching contractualism for this talk, I came upon all of these papers and, you know, I read the book and they all talk about the very specific details of, like, the theory of contractualism. I don't know if anyone's taken raise your hand if you've taken a philosophy class. All right, so you know how in philosophy class, they're like, let's talk about the word reasonable. And you're like, okay, but am I reasonable? Like, how do I do this? How do I actually take these principles that I've learned in philosophy class and bring them into my life so I can live a more ethical or more moral or just a life that I feel better about? And so I, Katya, Heroku engineer and jazz singer have decided, I don't know what I'm talking about, but I've decided that the best way to actually live a contractualist life is to just, like, try to do it, to try to reflect upon your actions and the work that you're doing and imagine how someone might feel. Imagine the objections someone might have to the things that you're doing. Now, this doesn't mean that we're not going to make mistakes. It doesn't mean that we're going to, like, great, I know this framework and I will write perfect software now and no one will be mad at me and everything I do will be great. But it means that our focus is going to be in the right places. And as engineers, we can spend so much time thinking about specific technical details that we kind of forget that we're making things for human beings. And it's really, really important that we not forget that. You know, there is no finish line. There's no moment where you can be like, super, we are ethical now, I'm done. You know, this is something that is ongoing. This is something that we're going to be doing every day for the rest of our lives, right? So let's talk about a couple practical tips. So these are things that you can do if you find yourself in a, let's say, ethically dicey situation. Maybe you're being asked to build something that you're not comfortable with. Maybe you're being asked to cut a corner. Maybe it's something that your company is doing and you just feel that you need to speak up about it. So the first thing is, most of us have been to a blameless retro if there's an incident or an outage, where you look at the situation, you figure out what went wrong, you figured out how to avoid it again. I think we need blameless ethics retros. So find an ethical issue, You're not pointing any fingers, you're not blaming anyone. You're just really looking at the situation and figuring out how we arrived here so we can avoid it in the future. My friends, software engineers are in demand. It's a great time to be a software engineer. So we have power. We need to use that power. It is much harder to hire a new engineer than it is to retain someone that you like. So don't forget, this is a privilege that we have that we must, as engineers, utilize anytime we find ourselves in a rough spot. So there may be tools that you have at your disposal should you encounter a situation that you're uncomfortable with. Maybe there is a manager that you trust you can bring this to. At Heroku Salesforce, we have an ethical and humane use department that actually has like a reporting form. Many companies have trust and safety departments. Like, there are often tools where you can like legitimately just like report something that feels wrong. Pushing back as a group is always going to be more effective than going on your own to talk to someone about something. It is much harder to say no to five engineers than it is to say no to just one. So, as engineers, we're the builders of things. And we can choose not to build things. We can also choose to build things differently. The buck stops with us. We are usually the last people that are maybe told about a thing before it ends up in the world. So often, you know, there's leadership, there's product managers, there's engineering managers who've all seen a potentially ethically dicey product and like said, super Katya, go right ahead. And so as those last people, you know, on the front lines, like we need to remember that this buck does stop with us. And it is our responsibility to ensure that if something is wrong, we're the ones that stop it. Finally, don't give up. You know, work is unfortunately an economic reality for most people. And you're going to fail. There's going to be a time where something goes wrong. And you try your best to you know, make sure that you don't ship something that you don't feel good about. And it's not going to work. And that's OK. It's still worthwhile to take that time to report something to as many people as you can, because maybe you move the line a little bit. Maybe the next time this situation comes up, someone feels differently. Maybe it encourages someone else who saw you bravely report something, maybe it encourages them to report it next time. And you know, if things are really bad, you just dust off your resume and you find a place to work that doesn't ask you to do so many bad things so frequently. So, there is no moral dessert. There's no reward that you get for doing the right thing, for doing all of these things. You just kind of have to keep on trying. You have to keep on doing your best. And I argue that the best gift of all is knowing that we have done right by our community. Thank you so much.